Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. We're kicking off a new podcasting project, a series of interviews with Ruth Institute's Circle of Experts. They're scholars and community leaders who are active in the marriage and life movements, and we'll be introducing one of our experts each week. If you're impatient, the complete list is on our website. Check out Circle of Experts in the nav bar on the left side of the page. Today, Dr. J is speaking with Tom Peters, cultural director at the National Organization for Marriage and blogger American Papist at CatholicVote.org. They're talking about yesterday's election and what's going on in the marriage movement.
Hello, Ruth Institute podcast listeners. This is Dr. J calling, and it's Wednesday, November 7th, kind of a dark day for marriage. It's foggy here, even in Southern California. We had a bad night last night. We had a rough night last night, but we're here to talk about the movement for marriage and what happened last night and what we might do going forward. And with me today is somebody who's one of the best people I can think of to have this conversation, Mr. Thomas Peters, who is on the Ruth Institute Circle of Experts, who is one of our speakers at this year's ITAF. And he talked to us about social media and how you can get involved, how you can be involved in the marriage movement. He's a full-time employee of the National Organization for Marriage and has been involved in their social media and their ground game in the state of Maine. So, Thomas, welcome to Ruth Institute Podcast.
Good to be with you, Dr. J.
Hey, listen, tell us what happened last night for those who threw themselves under the bed and pulled the covers over their heads and didn't want to hear anymore, which is kind of how I felt last night around 9 o'clock. Tell people what happened for marriage in last night's elections and what we might do going forward.
Well, first of all, when I woke up this morning, the coffee still tasted good and the coat, my winter coat still kept me warm. So that's a start. You know,
we have pretty low standards here, Tom.
Well, you got to start rebuilding somewhere.
Okay.
We lost in all four states that had a vote on the definition of marriage, which is, of course, incredibly disappointing. You know, we've worked hard for months and years in some of these states, and to lose is never a fun thing. We can take a little bit of consolation from the fact that all of these contests were in deep blue states, and that in all these states, marriage outperformed even the Republican ticket. So there's more bipartisan support for marriage than there is for who leads our country.
Okay, so let's hold it right there. The four states we're talking about are, what are the four states?
Oh, that's right. We had state votes in Minnesota to introduce a constitutional amendment defining marriage as a union of husband and wife, which failed to get the required 50% of votes. In Maine, our opponents introduced a ballot initiative to legalize same-sex marriage and won. And in Maryland and Washington State, our efforts to repeal same-sex marriage that had been passed by the legislators early this year failed.
Okay. And so when you say that our voting efforts in those states outperformed the Republican candidate, what you mean by that is more people voted in favor of traditional marriage than voted for the Romney-Ryan ticket. Is that what you mean?
That's correct.
Okay. And you know what? That was true 4 years ago in California on Proposition 8, Tom. More people voted yes on Prop 8 than voted for the Republican Party ticket. So it's a misnomer to say that somehow marriage is a losing issue. That's really not the case. But anyway, tell us more. You were actually in Maine, Tom. Tell us what that was like.
Well, you know, it's a question, you know, in politics, oftentimes the winner is the side that wants it more, you know, that wants to win. And our opponents in Maine have been working very hard for 3 years. We've only really been in the field this time around for 3 to 6 months in comparison. They had probably 10 to 1 when it comes to full-time staff. They outraised us monetarily, 4 to 1, 5 to 1. You know, I actually have a calluses on the interior of my palms from putting down about 500 yard signs over the last 2 days.
So tell us about the paid staff. You in Maine, these were not NOM employees up there. They were local people, and employed by whom? Who would be the ground team up there?
The state group was Protect Marriage Maine, and actually it was the full-time two staff was a married couple. Evangelical non-denominational couple, and they did, you know, they did amazing work. I was in their campaign headquarters, which is a room in the Christian Civic League in Maine, and from floor to ceiling it was papered with charts and like figures of how we did when Maine voted on same-sex marriage, and we won back in 2009. So they're very politically acute and aware and very motivated, and we were feeling very good going into the weekend. We had seen some encouraging poll numbers. We're never shown to be ahead in the polls, but we knew it would be a close contest, and I believe that out of over 600,000 votes cast in Maine, we only lost by 37,000 votes.
Mm-hmm. And so there were two paid staffers on our side, and how many paid staffers on the other side?
I'm not sure about paid staffers, but you know, I was kind of trolling our opponent's Facebook page, and they would send out photos of their volunteers, and there'd be, you know, several dozen people.
So
there's other people throughout the state. So anyway, I mean, the bottom line though is, you know, you can't just say when your state is voting on marriage that, well, I voted to protect marriage and that's enough. That's not enough in this culture. You have to contribute financially with your time, volunteers. We had great volunteers, but it's very clear we needed more.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Now, you've been involved in doing blogging and kind of keeping the non-blog site up to date and so on. And so you kind of have your finger on the pulse of things going on around the country. What can you tell us about how the situation in Maine compared with some of the other places, the three other places that were on the ballot? What other news can you give us about those places?
Sure. You know, Maine is a smaller state with less voters than a lot of other states. In Washington state, for instance, where we outspent closer to 10 to 1 to 12 to 1.
Oh, my gosh. I'm sorry. My head just went on tilt. You know, because in Prop 8, the spending was equal. I mean, it was really neck and neck on the spending across the state of California 4 years ago. So this is a new world that we've entered into. And in North Carolina, we were outspent 2 to 1. And that was just earlier this year. And now, four races on the ballot, outspent 10 to 1. In Washington state. Unbelievable. Go ahead. I'm sorry. But sorry to keep interrupting, but these are startling things that you're telling our listeners.
No, you work on something like this for months and months, and then in one night you get all the news at once. It takes a long time to digest and process.
Yes.
You know, and as you said, you know, we've been outspent 2 to 1, even 3 to 1 before and managed to win, but you can't win if you know, being outspent 6 to 1. It's simply, you know, people need encouragement to hold to their pro-marriage views because there's so many cultural forces that are trying to push people away from this view. And like all good propaganda is done through repetition, that's what our opponents had on their side. You know, they had, I think, I don't know even how many TV ads on their side. Funded by large, wealthy pro-gay marriage CEOs. The founder of Amazon.com, for instance, alone gave a $2.5 million check to our opponents. The Bill and Melinda Gates of Microsoft gave $600,000. Brad Pitt gave money. You know,
yes.
There's a huge effort. I'm amazed even there how close the final was. The idea that same-sex marriage is inevitable is still not true. You know, the vast majority of Americans who have voted on marriage at this point have voted to protect marriage, and we can still pray very hard to see what the Supreme Court does when they take up Proposition 8 and the Defense of Marriage Act in the next term.
Yes, and you know, I want to go back to this inevitability thing, you know, because we've been told over and over that we're on the wrong side of history, that gay marriage is inevitable, you guys might as well stay home, don't even bother to get involved, so on and so forth. But you know what? If it's really inevitable, you shouldn't need to outspend your opponents 8 to 1. You know, I mean, if history's really going to take care of itself, Lady History should not need that much coaxing if this is really some kind of inevitable march of history. So what you're saying here and what we're seeing here is that the some very rich people in our country are expending all of their resources or a lot of their resources to making gay marriage a reality in this country. And they're not just flowing with history. They are putting a lot of time, energy, and resources into creating a historical outcome that they want. And it seems to me that itself undercuts the historical so-called inevitability of this thing.
You know, Dr. Morris, just to add an anecdotal, you know, observation I had when I was in Maine to support what you're saying, I closed my eyes last night and I saw our marriage sign in my eyes because I've looked at it so many times as I was putting it down on, you know, intersections, et cetera. Now, we, even in the more liberal parts of Maine, I'd say that we had, when it came to yard signs, 5-1 as many as they did.
Is that so?
But the thing is, our signs would only stay up for about maybe a couple hours before someone would come and take our sign. I found dozens of, I have pictures, I have dozens of our signs just riddled on the ground as people tore them up. You know, I would hazard a guess that our opponents spent more time taking down our signs than putting their own. And any movement that has to convince people by doing it that way doesn't win in the end. It was amazing. We doubled back on some of the places we went to the day before and put up signs. Would find more than half of them picked up and taken away. In every one of these states, this is always what happens. A movement has to silence the other side as much as it talks is not a movement that, you know, is going to affect permanent change.
But the problem, Tom, is that, you know, I agree with that and I respect what you're saying, but the problem is that if one side becomes very adept at obtaining the levers of power and maneuvering the levers of power, if they do these kinds of acts of vandalism and get away with it steadily because the powers that be won't intervene, we're going to have a problem long term. You know, there's no doubt about it. So, I don't know. There's nothing more to say, I guess. But just to agree with you that this is not a fair fight. What I've observed from my kind of more academic post and more cultural post on this thing is that the arguments on either side have not really changed that much. I feel like we here at the Ruth Institute continue to bring forth new arguments to counter the kind of talking points that come up on the other side. But the fact is the other side is not winning on arguments. They're not even really making arguments anymore, at least as far as I can see the dialogue. You know, they're saying the same old tired talking points, but really what they're saying is, we have more money than you do. We have more friends in high places than you do. This is what we're going to do. We mean to do it, and it doesn't matter to us whether you win the argument or not. So tell me, have you heard new and exciting, innovative arguments coming at us from the other side?
No, I really think that the liberal, you know, the gay marriage movement has largely abandoned even the pretense of having the high level philosophical debate over marriage. I think it seems simply that they're even more readily acknowledging that they simply are going to ignore the arguments against redefining marriage and simply do it.
That's right.
As just a raw expression of cultural willpower.
Yes, that's my impression as well. So the real question in my mind is, why do the rich people of our country want gay marriage so badly? You know, because it's not just rich gay people. There are a bunch of rich Republicans who are dumping money into this thing who, as far as I can tell, are not gay. That was the pattern that we saw in New York State. The first big legislature that we really lost, we lost because of big Wall Street Republican money going in on the gay marriage side. Do you have any thoughts about that, Tom? Why do the rich people in our country so badly want to redefine marriage to remove the gender requirement, make marriage into a genderless institution? What are they thinking?
Well, I think there's a broad number of reasons. I would say one thing that legalized same-sex marriage is a repudiation of the West's tradition of the religious tradition.
Yes.
If you look at other, you know, countries, you know, where you've had strong left and right governments that lean towards the totalitarian side, organized religion is the single greatest check on the expansive government power. And so if you can stand up to the religious communities in this country and say we're going to redefine something that you see as a sacrament deeply embedded in the nature of reality and the history of, you know, the church since Christ came, you can do a lot more. So I think, you know, you find an affinity on the our opponent's side when it comes to saying no to and a continued influence of the church in the public square, even though the church, as we know, is simply witnessing to a human truth, not trying to impose a religious truth. But that's something they again simply choose to ignore.
Well, you know what's interesting about this is if you just think about the future of a society, there really isn't any future in sodomy. You know, sodomy cannot produce children. So, you know, that's a little odd to say that we're on the wrong side of history. They're on the right side of history. There's no future in abortion. You know, baby killing doesn't make the next generation. There's no future really in contraception. You know, having sterile sex, sterilizing the sexual act. And actually, all of these things are examples of sterilizing the sexual act. There's no future in that. So how can we be on the wrong side of history? And those guys are marching to the tune of history. How can this possibly be? This is just an astonishing reversal, in a sense. We're standing reality on its head, Tom.
Well, I mean, if you believe that humanity is fundamentally good and that human beings are always a good in themselves, then a future full of human beings sounds wonderful. But if you ascribe to a lot of the positions of, broadly speaking, our ideological opponents, who don't see humanity necessarily as a good in itself, that see the world as overpopulated,
mm-hmm.
and see the world as an area of finite resources. I find when I make arguments about, I find that when I make arguments to some segments of younger people, and I say what's driving our entitlement crisis is partially our depleted birth rate. Actuarial tables don't lie.
Right.
That would be a huge problem going forward. You know, and I say, well, you know, this is why we need to promote responsible, you know, procreation within marriage. They look at me and they say, well, the world's overpopulated. Why should we be promoting that at all?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. It's a resurgence of Gnosticism, which really hates the human body and hates the human race. You know, the whole human race is a problem. And that you're right. That's a big part of the environmental anti-religion or alternative religion, whatever you want to call it. And people have drunk deeply from that well.
Dr. Morris, maybe I can just toss in a random thought, which might kind of give us some sense of context for what just happened last night.
Okay.
Well, last night was a very bad night for marriage, but it was also a very good night in Massachusetts, of all places. Physician-assisted suicide lost by a very narrow margin, legalizing, in other words. So, you know,
yes.
A victory for care of the elderly and the sick and the disabled. In the polling in September showed us behind 30 points, and we closed that gap in large part because liberal Democrats in Massachusetts came to our side. And finally, our arguments finally broke through that this is against human dignity. This is anti-life. This promotes the exploitation of the weak and underprivileged and disabled. And that's the coalition that won. So Massachusetts actually affirmed the life and dignity of the elderly. That's, first of all, good news for huge debates we'll be having in the next two decades about the respect to elders, especially of an aging population. But it also shows that there can be great surprises, even among people who we'd think of as our, you know, historical opponents, when suddenly just the truth of an argument breaks through. And so I think that's something that the people who protect marriage should look to realize that the fight is never over and that the truth ultimately wins, often in surprising ways, even after setbacks like this.
Well, Tom, that's a great observation. I hadn't heard that. I had that in the back of my mind that there was a euthanasia measure on the ballot, and I'm really glad to hear that euthanasia was defeated in the state of Massachusetts. So that's one bit of really great news. Thomas, there are a lot of things people can do to get involved with the Ruth Institute. There are things people can do to get involved with the National Organization for Marriage. Would you just share with our listeners like the top two things that you think everybody should be doing going forward?
Sure. Well, the first thing is to go to nomblog.com, which is the blog I and a couple others run, which has the latest marriage news. That's the one-stop hub. I put stuff online there so I don't have to like bring it up every time I talk to people. That's my one go-to resource.
By the way, a lot of Ruth Institute stuff ends up over there too, just so people know, because you could get stuff at Ruth Institute, but a lot of it shows up at Nomblog as well. Yeah, go ahead. So what's your next thing?
Yeah, it's a great reciprocal relationship. Honestly, if people just want to follow me on Twitter, I talk a lot about these broader issues, and I try to point people to sort of like my ongoing reading list to keep informed. And, that's where to start if you care about protecting marriage and also just want to hear more of what I'm reading that helps inform my opinions. And again, Ruth Institute pops up in that Twitter feed. So it's all good together. And then also, I think, we have an education effort on our hands here. There are too few people who know the truths we know. And so to start thinking about ways and habits you can get into of sharing that with, beginning with your friends and family, that's the paramount, you know, generational challenge we face now.
And I would like to invite all of our listeners to go to ruthinstitute.org and sign up for the Ruth Institute weekly newsletter, where we keep you informed about all of these type of developments, not so much the political activity or the political activism, but very much the information, the arguments, the educational things that you can do to help promote marriage within your circle of influence. So go to ruthinstitute.org, sign up for our free weekly e-newsletter. You'll be glad you did. You will be very well informed if you follow that every week. And also, folks, I know this is a bad time to say this because a lot of you have already given a lot of money to political campaigns, but now, between political seasons, now is the time to be giving to the educational organizations such as the Ruth Institute. Now is the time to be building up the educational and cultural infrastructure that allows us to lay the groundwork for whatever else has to be done, because it's not just a matter of politics. It's also a matter of changing the hearts and the minds of the people in this culture, and also to embolden one another, those of us whose hearts and minds are already very deeply committed to marriage, who are very deeply committed to life, to the cause of life, from conception through to natural death. Those of us who are already committed to these things need to be emboldened and speak out, and we need to support one another. So we very much want to see you on the Ruth Institute Facebook page, my personal fan page, Jennifer Roback Morse, on Facebook, and the ruthinstitute.org newsletter, weekly newsletter. So thank you, Tom Peters, so much for being with us. Tom Peters of the American Papist blog and also the National Organization for Marriage. Thomas, thanks so much for being with us.
Always a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
You've just been listening to Dr. J interviewing Tom Peters, the first in a series of interviews with our circle of experts. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.